Okay. This is Raymond. I'm the developer on the Yale OpenHand project, and today we're going to go over the assembly for a Model T underactuated hand. I'm just going to try to go over the steps. So you'll see that a lot of the parts have already been assembled, but for those of you who might have trouble with the assembly, hopefully this video will make things a lot more clear. I'm going to try to do this entire video in one take. So some long pauses, but hopefully it'll give you a good idea of how long the whole assembly process takes. Okay, so first thing we do is you'll see that all these fingers have been post-processed already. So we've already poured the urethanes, we've already removed the removable walls, and we've drilled the tendon ports entirely. So at this point, most of these pins can be inserted by hand. If you find that you can't insert the pins properly, you might need to take another undersized reamer and go through these holes one more time. The smaller pins in the default design uses an undersized 1/8 inch, and these bigger holes use an undersized 1/4 inch. But you can kind of see here, we can kind of just pop pretty easy. If you need to, you can press it against a table to push the pin in that final bit, or I tend to have a set of pliers on hand, just in case. One thing to watch out for is after you insert the pin, you want to double check to make sure that the tendon port is still open so you can thread a tendon through. As you're doing it, you might want to take an extra tendon piece and just kind of thread it through as you're pushing in these pins, just to make sure that these tendons still slide freely. If they don't slide freely, you can take a 16th inch drill bit and then just take a hand drill and go through these tendon ports a little bit to clean up the hole, and that will usually get the job done. Make sure these are right size. They're not. There we go. These are two major types of fingers. So here we have the fingers with the flexure at the proximal base, and these use a pin joint at the proximal base. For each hand, there's going to be four of each type, so we'll just go ahead and do what I just did a couple more times. So hang tight. No, got the wrong ones. in mind is that for a lot of these features where we have to put the pins in, there's usually a print adjustable in CAD files. So if you have a particular 3D printer that deals with tolerances a little bit differently, that might be something you want to adjust before you print these parts. We've tested all of our hands on Stratasys machines. So we have a U-Print and a Fortis in our lab, and those are the machines that we've tested these designs on. So your mileage may vary depending on your printer. And there we go. We have four sets of fingers. I mean, sets of fingers, four in each set. All right, first let me do these flexure-based fingers since their assembly is very easy. If you check in the CAD library, we have two sets of tops, right? One for each type of finger base. For the flexure ones, it's pretty straightforward. Oh, actually, you know what? Before that, there's another thing we can do first. If you check on the back, we've done this thing now where you can actually put in an insert to help you better tie off the tendons. Before, what we would do is we just have you tie off the tendon at a nut and just have it anchored there. But we found recently that sometimes if you use inserts, it tends to be a lot more professional and also a lot more robust. Right, so the inserts we use are these tiny 440 heat set inserts. So what you do is a soldering iron. And there's a couple of other YouTube videos out there that will probably demonstrate what I'm doing if you want to search for those. But what you do is you kind of place the inserts at these holes. Be careful. You apply some heat. If you wait a while, you'll see that it begins to go down. What I like to do is right before it hits the end, I'll stop and I'll take a flat piece and kind of push these inserts flat. And then you'll see what we have there. You can see that the insert sits in really nicely. And after you have the inserts in, you can just thread in a 440 bolt. And now, at the end of our assembly process, when we thread our tendons, you can just tie off to this bolt here instead of having to tie around a loose nut. So we found that sometimes that makes things a little bit easier. So let's do it for the rest of these fingers. I have seen some people use press fit inserts, but for personal preference, I like these heat side inserts better for 3D printed parts. In my mind, since they're kind of melting into the part, they seem a little bit more robust. Another nice thing is that if you want to recover these, you can just apply heat and you can actually retract them. Granted, you may damage the 3D printer part, so just keep that in mind. There we go. And now let me do these other fingers too, just so we're all ready there. More inserts. last one. Cool. All right. Enough of the soldering iron. Back to these flexure based fingers and the top. Like I said, pretty straightforward. Kind of poke the fingers in through from the bottom. If it's giving you a little bit of trouble, don't worry. These fingers are really robust, so we shouldn't worry about them breaking. If they do, that's something you should contact us about so that we can fix it properly. You might have a little bit of a clearance issue with these pins. But for the most part, they should go through pretty easily. As you're inserting them, back side first, and then the front side, you'll see that it's kind of rounded. So you should be able to rotate it into place and just kind of push. And we make sure it's flush. And there you go. It's the finger. One thing to keep in mind is that, oh, you know what? I actually installed this in reverse. It's actually a good lesson right here. The flexure-based design is a little bit that the placement of the fingers might be opposite what you expect, as I just kind of did there. So at the end, the joint of the base is here, and then the tendon actually comes up, which might be the opposite of what you'd expect. You might expect it to go like this, but it's actually the other way. If you refer to the CAD, it might make it a little bit more clear so that you don't make the mistake that I just did. There we go. Hopefully I won't mess this up anymore. The tolerances for these tight fits, like I said, for the pins, is also a value that you can adjust in the CAD. So that might be something to keep in mind. As you're inserting them, if you see that these pins aren't pressed in all the way, you might want to take your pliers. There we go. Nope, here. And make sure they're as flush as possible. That might help you out a little bit in terms of getting the fingers through. Same goes for these base pins. Sometimes they don't push all the way through. It might cause you some problems. There we go. Okay, final finger. Let's see. Some fingers require a little bit more elbow grease than others. And there we go. Make sure the bottom of these fingers are flush against the surface. You should be done with this segment. And here we have the top for a set of flexure-based fingers. All right, I'm gonna put that away. Done with this. Now with these pivot-based ones, the assembly is a little bit more complicated. So be a little bit more careful. These come with these extra bases here. And so we'll assemble these first. These actually utilize a set of pulleys at the base here. We do have a separate design where the pulleys are instead replaced by a quarter inch. And that's for the people who can't get a hold of these pulleys. We've only managed to find these at McMaster. That's the only source we'll be able to find these. That's a little bit inconvenient for those of you without access to McMaster. But with the pins, you do lose a great deal of efficiency due to the capstan effect, but we make both options open, optional. Both options available, just in case. Let's see here. The right one. Nope. There we go. All right. To insert this, you should pop the pulley in. Make sure it can spin freely. So if you find that the pulley's not kind of floating in there, then your tolerances were probably wrong. You might be able to fix that if you take a small file and try to go in and deburr the surfaces. Otherwise, you may need to reprint. It's pretty critical that these pulleys spin as freely as possible. For this part, I sometimes take a bigger pair of pliers. Move this pin in. Alright, so we get it in. I move the pulley in position. And we push the pin in the rest of the way. Make sure it's flush on both sides. After you pull it in, you might want to take a small pair of screwdrivers or a toothpick or something. Just make sure the pulley can spin freely. That's something you want to, again, make sure is happening on each of these as we do them. There we go. Now in the front here, there's another pin that needs to be installed. Oh, these are all ones too. Yeah, we don't see off cameras that have a huge pile of pins of various sizes. And apparently, I'm getting all of them mixed up at the best time. We have these bases, and they all should only pop in one way, so I don't think there's any way I can mess it up here. They might be a little tight to press through. You may get to the point where you need to use like a rubber mallet or something to get these through sometimes. Or you could go back through the CAD and readjust some of the print values. When you have a tight fit, good idea, like I said before, to double check some of these pins. Not all of them may be flush with the ABS. That could cause some problems. No problem. You know what? I'll be back. I'm gonna take a rubber mallet to this. Bring this here. Hopefully the audio doesn't get too ridiculous. If it does, I'll try to mute that section out. I like to have a vise like this in case I need to mallet some of these pieces in. Not mallet, hammer. You get the idea. Now, for the most part, shouldn't be this difficult, but sometimes you get a couple of those prints where the tolerances don't come out quite right. You have to resort to measures, which is what we're doing now. Make sure that's flush. This may be problematic when we get to the end. We'll see. Now for these pin joint fingers, this next bit is a little bit tricky, so pay attention if you can. For the return spring, we have these torsion. Now these have been pre-cut. I cut them on a drum. I advise that you don't use wire cutters because you will destroy your wire to cut torsion springs. A Dremel works really nicely. If you look at the top of these pin joint based fingers, there are two holes. The one in the center is for the tendon, the one off to the side is for the short leg of this torsion spring. And I'll do this four times, so hopefully you guys will be able to catch it. There's a slot on one side of these fingers. That's where the long leg kind of goes through. We should have the large quarter inch base pin ready to go. What you do is you kind of just slot it in. Make sure you hold the end of the torsion spring. We'll spring back against that long eighth inch pin we installed earlier in the base. And then through the side, most of the time you should actually be able to just push it in by hand if you did your reaming correctly. There you go. Push it in by hand. If you look in the back, the quarter inch pin goes through the middle of the torsion spring, and then at the end you should get this nice spring back behavior, right? So I'm just gonna do this four more times. Try to give you a different vantage point every time so you can see what I'm doing. Alright, torsion spring, short leg, the side hole, long leg through the slot. Shouldn't pop out. Slot it in place. Grab a base pin. Goes in. Now, sometimes, if it's a tight fit and you push the quarter inch pin in, you might actually jam the finger. So if the finger doesn't slide back freely like this, a nice thing to do is take a small flathead screwdriver, kind of go in between the finger and these side panels here, and kind of wedge it in a little bit and free it up. Because sometimes you can accidentally clamp the two sides together. This is plastic after all. And so be careful. Did I lose it? Okay. All right. If you can't push the button by hand, use pliers. There we go. Right. Great. So make sure everything's smooth, and we can move on to the next part. As I said before, we're using these 440 bolts now to terminate the tendons. So I'll kind of screw them in now. Before we get to the next step. So I'll be doing this example with the pin joint based fingers instead of the flexure based fingers, but the next bit should pretty much be the same. Okay. We have a pulley trigger. Be the next step. This next step is super easy. I think it's these pins. There we go. Okay. Do is press the pins in on one side. These are kind of small, so wires to help you out. There we go. Now for these floating ones, stick a pulley in. And the other one just sandwiches it. Don't worry about which side is which, they're identical. So just pop them in. Again, as is the case, any small sub-assembly with pulleys, you want to make sure these pulleys are still free-spinning. Just something to double-check. Awesome. Now this smaller one, you may want to wait a bit before you fully assemble it, but I think I'll fully assemble it now. If we run into problems, I'll disassemble it and as I'm looking at this, one of them is not sliding that great. There seems to be a little bit of a burr, so I'm going to get a pair of files. Okay, I don't know if you can see it here, but there's a small burr to the side there. Giving us a little bit of problems. For my first pass, I usually like to take a blade and just kind of scrape at it a couple of times. Oftentimes, they'll get the bigger burrs off pretty quickly. Happened on this one, too? Yeah, happened on this one, too. Weird. And then, as a last resort, you can come in with the file, just kind of smooth things over a little bit. It's ABS, so pretty easy to deal with. Just make sure you don't take off too much. And then when you put it back in, okay, that slides a lot more easily. A little interesting thing about this middle one is that in the end your pins are going to protrude outwards a little bit. That's by design because we want the pins to accidentally pop out of these press fits since this is going to be connected to the main drive pulley. So to be safe, sometimes I go in. Nope. Press the pin in a little bit more, just so it's kind of protruding at both sides. For the most part, it's not a big deal, but it might make things easier in the future. Let's see if I pinch the pulleys. No, still free spinning. All right, cool. Right. Back to these fingers. This is where we break out the tendon. And, sometimes this step gives people a lot of problems. Well, all the tendon steps. Apparently, not too many people are used to building things with tendons, which is understandable. Alright. So this is the piece that comes in and sandwiches. You should see that there are four large holes for the four main posts that's going to hold the hand together, and four smaller holes for the tendon routing. The four smaller tendon routing holes should go here, 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 and here. For the flexor-based hand, it's similar, right? Here, 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 and here. So as long as you line up these tabs and the major and minor holes, you should be good to go. Should just kind of slot in pretty easily. Sometimes at this point, it's easier if we install the posts already. So as I mentioned before, there are these four big posts that kind of eventually tie everything together. And at this point, we just kind of hand screw it on. It's not a big deal. Hopefully I haven't messed up anything major yet. If I do, we'll deal with it when we get to it. So one of the nice things about this hand is that, as you kind of saw earlier, these finger tops are pretty much interchangeable. You can just swap them out as you see fit, depending on what your needs are. So, in a second. All right, back. All right, tendons. So what happens is the tendons get terminated on each side to a pair of fingers, and they run down through the top base, through these tendon ports, and then through this floating tendon block here. So it's going to be one continuous loop of tendon. It basically just connects two fingers through this floating pulley block. What I like to do is, first I'll cut out a fairly long piece of spectra tendon. A sharp blade here. Careful when using sharp blades. Like I said, we had these posts earlier to make things easier to tie off on. I like to tie at least one of these ends with a no-slip knot. It's hard to do no-slip knots of tendons of exact length, unless I'm just missing a really nice knot out there that allows me to do that. Use your knot of preference, I guess. I think everyone has their own preference when it comes to knot tying. But you'll find that with a lot of these designs, just a couple of half-inch probably won't do the job, because they'll tend to slip over time. Knot tying is not the best. So may have to redo this one. It's not sliding down as I'd like. Huh, I messed that up. And this is why we start off with a slightly longer piece of tendon in case we mess up the knot tying early on. Alright, let's try that again. This one's a lot better. Hopefully, we checked our tendon ports from earlier, and these tendons will just thread through really nicely. And this next part, the tendons go around the base of the finger and then back over the pulley that we installed in the base and then through the bottom here. You'll see that at the base of these fingers there's a center groove for the tendon to kind of ride on, so that can be a nice assembly guide. Next part may be a little bit difficult. It's possible I jumped the gun in installing these bases without tying these tendons. They should line up nicely. But apparently not today. If that's the case, you might need to disassemble this just temporarily, so we can make sure the tendon comes through cleanly. Now we've got it going through the bottom. All right. One thing you might want to test is that you can actuate the finger by pulling on it. Just make sure everything's running smoothly. Tendons aren't getting caught. Before I put this back on, I think I'll tie off the other finger, just like we did this first set. So we don't have to go through that again. Tendons are giving you problems. You might want to pre-loop these tendons so you can go through some of these curves a little bit more easily. But even that may not always be the solution. Try a straight shot. Ah, there we go. Okay. Make sure I just lined up correctly. Thread it through. This one through. Like I said, I'll go through these floating pulleys. So do not wrap around this bottom pin here, right? It should only be contact pulleys at the top. Sometimes these tendons tend to get caught because our tolerances are a little bit tight on some of these printed parts. The reason for that is we don't want the tendons to jump out off the pulley and then get caught somewhere. So these differential pieces in the floating pulley ideally need to move as freely as possible. At this point, I think we can use without too much concern. But like I just did, if you run into any other issues, you can pretty easily take these apart again. Right back to the top. On each side, we're gonna route these tendons back up again and then terminate the end. Won't do that twice. Hopefully I haven't made this super myself, but I think I just did. The nice, or probably more not so nice thing about these designs is that you'll end up probably redoing a different tendon strategy every single time. It's a little unfortunate. There we go. Sometimes a small pair of tweezers or screwdriver help you out with these hard to reach spots. Right, now when you pull this tight, the folding pulley lock should be flush up against this top plate. You want to tie it ideally as tight as possible here. One easy thing we can do is, as you're pulling it tight, wrap it around this post a couple of times, and we can use the capstan effect to our benefit here. That should generally hold it in place as you're tying your knots. This knot, I generally wrap it around a couple of times, tie a couple of half hitches, and just really simple knots, and I call it a day. If you have a better knot, you should definitely use it. Maybe I'll leave it as this. Cannot for the life of me get this tendon through. Cool. At the end of the day, remember these are a couple together. So So when you move one, the other one should move also. And you can pull the bottom, make it actuate. I generally like to keep this extra bit of tendon here, just in case I need to retie it later when we're calibrating. So I'll leave that there. Now, let's see if I can tie a little bit faster than I did the first. Yeah, that works a lot better. Cool. As you're running these, try to make sure that tendons are running in their center and not getting stuck in the clearances for the torsion springs. Sometimes that'll happen. There we go. Pull it tight. And same thing we did with the other side fingers. Alright, that one went a lot more easily. So you end up something like this. You can test both sides out, make sure you can actuate them, and we'll move on to the next step. Alright, I'm going to bring the servo in. So we're using these Dynamixel MX64. I think the RX64 will also work, but we picked the 64 model because we need the higher torque for a four-fingered hand. You'll see that the other models we have on our site was the MX32 and the RX. Those are a lot smaller, but different models. You'll see here we took the back off. The reason is we have an extra panel where we attach a little 12-volt fan. This provides a little bit of cooling for the servo so that it runs a little bit better when we're higher power. So these bolts or screws here are the same ones that we had used to attach the back of the Dynamixel. So we're just reusing them here. and with the fan, make sure you know which side is which. And all you do is you just kind of slot it in, and then it'll snap in just like that. With the end here, people do it a couple of different ways. On this one, you'll see that there's an end soldered directly onto the servo, and so we're just using the voltage and current directly from the servo to power the fan. You can use any set of cables you want. Sometimes I'll cut open one of the Dynamixel cables and then hook it up directly to the fan, and it'll just do that. So I think it plugs in like this. And then that's it for the servo. The servo will come with some of these default bolts. For this model, we don't have to use these smaller bolts because we have a slightly different drive pulling. So make sure you keep this main bolt here. That's a little bit important. All right, next step, we have the drive pulley. On some of the newer designs, we have these small printed nubs at the end such that we don't need this locking bolt here. But we left the option open just in case people want to go for it. As I did with the, I'll cut out a longer piece. And we'll just end up wrapping this around the pulley if we have too much. At the pulley level, you want to tie a no-slip knot. You see that there are two holes here and little notches there, and that's where I generally like to tie off these pulleys. If you find a better spot that makes a little bit more sense, let me know. Now the other end, before you tie it, we're actually going to do a little bit more assembly on this servo here. Need two more of these pulleys. Make sure it's the right size. This attaches onto the servo here. What did I do with the smaller bolts? I think these are just bolts that allow you to kind of lock this plate in place. Small screwdriver. Pulley that goes in there. I'm going to take my file, clean it up a little bit. And I've already messed it up. Great. Now, if you find that for whatever reason, some of these pins are a little too loose, just put a dab of glue, cyanoacrylate or epoxy at the end, and they usually hold them in just fine. Top panel goes here. Huh. Now it's giving me problems. Great. There we go. Yeah, I was wondering why there wasn't that much clearance. Yeah, one of these pins is a little loose. I'm just going to play it safe. Alright, so I have some cyanoacrylate here. I'm just going to put a dab at one of these ends. Make sure this pin holds in place. Try not to use thin cyanoacrylate, since that might leak through and clog up the rotation of these pulleys. As always, gonna check to make sure these pulleys are still free spinning, and they are, so that's nice. Alright, so with this pulley, I'm just gonna lock it in place now, but we'll unlock it at a later point in time. Like I mentioned with the nubs, they kind of, you can rotate around by, and it'll kind of notch itself in place. Just put in for now. And the way this goes is the tenon goes in this direction. So if you're looking at the servo, it's clockwise. Did I get that right? Yeah, clockwise. I'll route it around 3 times-ish. Then route it on the right side of the pulley. And then up through and around. Now on this other side, this was the folding pulley from earlier, we also want a no slip knot. I mentioned I might take this apart again if it becomes a little too difficult for me to thread through. Let's see if I can rethread this. Might end up being useful. You know what? To disengage some of these, you can just maybe that won't do it. Maybe I do have to totally disassemble this. There we go. Pop that back together. Tie a strong knot. Alright, so we have our setup here. This is the base for the bottom. I just situate it in place. Should go flush against the bottom. The tabs or the sides of these dynamics should slot into these clearances here. It should be a nice snug fit. We have the setup here. So I mentioned earlier that tendon tying the fingers was tough. From what I've heard, this next part might even be tougher. These are the small pulley blocks that eventually go here at the bottom of the fingers, at the bottom of the hand. Put in our final pulleys. Yeah. Now you note that these bottom pulleys are angled in a particular way. That's something you want to watch out for. They're going to be angled towards the back of the servo when you install them. So in our next step, make sure you have them positioned correctly. Otherwise, it's going to be a little bit weird. Alright, this is the part where we bring these two main parts together. And hopefully, it won't end up taking forever. Try and do this last part. Try to clear out the table here and get a better look at things. Right, so same with the fingers. On at least one of these sides, you want to tie a no-slip knot just because we can. But again, it's going to be an exact length tendon that we're trying to anchor. So I don't think you can tie a no-slip knot on the other end. Try to make sure there's no slack here. Alright, this next part. I'm going to try to give as many viewpoints as possible so that it's not super confusing, although I'm sure it still will be. What we want to do is we're going to put the top on. This feature here goes around the top of the pulley. Make sure you don't snag the pulley as you're snapping it in place. I'll try to go over a couple of alternative ways of doing this next step. Although I like to at least start it off here so I can kind of kind of measure everything. Should be a snug. That's beginning to look like a hand. All right. So. We'll end up running the tendon through this pulley. Again, make sure you have the orientation right, such that eventually this pulley block will be angled towards the back. Once you run it through there, it's going to run through the center drive pulley. No, don't go that way. There we go. Same for this other one. Make sure it's going the right way. All right, so this next part, there's a couple of ways. You'll notice the bottom, these holes here are a little bit weird. It's because we can actually pull these here, slot them like this, make them go through, and then turn them, and then lock them in place. We initially did that because we thought it would make things easier, but a lot of people like to just install everything and then try to tie in place, even though that's a lot less clearance that way. We can give that a try first, and we'll see how far we get. So like I said, you can push the pulleys through. When they come through, you can rotate, and you can pop them back in again. Try not to lose track of your tendon, otherwise I'll need to do that last step again, which I think would be painful. Alright, so in this next step, what you want is, you want to pull it tight such that this main drive pulley is flush against the bottom plate. If it helps, you might want to bolt this bottom plate down first, but I think the consensus is sometimes it's a lot easier if you have freedom to be able to remove this if necessary as you're tying this last step. Depending on how your parts have printed, you might see a gap down here. If you do, you should get a couple of washers to kind of level out. I'm just double checking to make sure I didn't miss something else. Maybe, maybe not. Everything seems okay. We got a couple of washers. I'll be right back. Hold this rig. Well, if you're having a little bit of difficulty, we can drop off this bottom plate entirely. See what's up. Actually, since we're already at this stage, might as well bring in the final plate here. Well, this final plate should only go in one way. That should make things a little bit easier. Oh, that's why. What do you know? Wrong washer. Alright, I think I wasted enough time. We'll skip the washers for now. We'll put them in at another point if we still need them. So did we get this tangled? Do some maintenance on this pin here. Yep. Got him tangled. Okay, this is where it might actually be helpful. For us to loosen the main drive pulley. Try to take up some of the slack in the main tendon. Nope. There we go. All right. Now we're getting a little bit closer. Cool. Yeah, I'll put in the bolts for now. Oh, there's two of them. Just temporary to hold it in place. Alright, like I said before, this next step, we want to make sure that this block is as flush with the bottom as possible. This is another case where the capstan effect can be used to our advantage. The only difficulty is there's almost next to no clearance to make this happen. What some people like to do is to just measure out the length they want, and then tie it before the assembly step, which is just kind of smart. Sometimes it's just easier to just tie it like this and deal with it. Right, so two loops around. Flush. There are times where sometimes I'll mark off that tendon point right there with like a marker or something, just so I have a reference point for what I'm trying to tie to. You don't have to be too concerned. If you do have a little bit of slack, it's not that big of a deal. You'll survive. And the hand will probably still work. And we can all go home pretty happy. Alright. Now let's see if I can tie this in place. Got a reasonable knot. Now if it ends up being too loose, you'll find out pretty quickly as you're trying to actuate this. So you'll know. And as I said before, I tend to like to leave a little bit of extra length just in case I have to go back. Super pretty good. So, you know what? This is just the intro video. I'll tie off these tendons here. Or trim these tendons here. So we don't have to deal with it. All right, this is the basic assembly of the hand. We're pretty much done. If you give a tug at the center drive pulley here, just pull up. You can kind of see how they actuate the four fingers. All right, the next step, I'm gonna zero the servo. Okay, so for the final step, we need to initialize the hand. So to do that, we hook up the hand, we run the servos to its zero point, and then we loosen this main drive pulley here and we rotate until this final tendon is tight. So once we connect to it, we've moved it to its zero position. Now we mechanically loosen this main drive pulley. You shouldn't have to unscrew this bolt all the way. You should be able to pop it out and then rotate it. Should make it easier. If you need a little bit more clearance or firsts, let's get it locked in place there. You'll note that now it's almost impossible to get to that center bolt in order to tighten it. So what you can do is you can pull these fingers together, generate a little bit more slack around this pulley. Now you should have access. At least enough to kind of have this Allen wrench in there. And then you can tighten it down in place. Once that's clear, now you should have a hand. Let's see if we can make this thing move a little bit. There you go. Now you may want to go back and kind of tune it. These fingers should be kind of closing at the same rate, at least until they hit an object. But that's a minor thing at this point. So that's it. This is how you build and initialize a Model T hand. Thanks.